ElevateEdAZ. Oh, perfect.
There we go.
I'm not sure if you've met Melanie before, so I might let her introduce herself to you.
Hi, Leah. I'm Melanie Bach. I work with the Center for the Future of Arizona. Excited to hear your presentation today. So thanks so much.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for the opportunity to be here and good to see you both, ladies.
Yes. So I don't know, Melanie, should I give another minute or should we just jump right in it? I'm not sure what our count looks like. Oh, you're on mute and I don't know if you're...
Sorry, I am on mute. We have 12 that have joined.
Okay, perfect. So should we just go right ahead?
Yeah, let's jump in. And
All right.
We are recording, so here we go, guys.
Here we go. Here's my little spiel. So hello and welcome to the Spring 2021 Virtual Educator Externship, hosted by ElevateEdAZ, the Center for the Future of Arizona, Arizona Business and Education Coalition, and Pima County Superintendent's Office. As a reminder, we ask that you please keep your cameras on for the duration of the session and ensure your microphone is on mute if you're not speaking. Today's session is hosted by Leah Hill from HonorHealth, who will discuss career paths, employability skills, current career opportunities, and the culture of learning and development in her organization. And Leah Hill.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. How are you all doing? Excellent. I see some thumbs up and feel free to use your emoticons down below, but I thrive on your interaction. So I would love to hear from you. And this session is all about you. I want to make sure that you get your money's worth. And since you all had free tickets, then the sky's the limit as to what kind of quality training or what kind of quality session you can expect. So I'm shooting for the stars and I hope you will too. And we're going to have a great time together, have some fun, and hopefully you'll learn something about HonorHealth that you don't already know. Casey, Melanie, would I be able to share my screen by chance? Otherwise, I can do this without a script, don't worry. But I just thought that I wanted to let you all know I put some time and energy into our time together. And I do have some cool visuals to show you all.
Leah, you should be able to share your screen now.
Perfect. Thank you, Melanie. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and pull up my presentation. But I want you to know that I am happy to deviate from this presentation. So I don't believe in death by PowerPoint. I believe in conversations and interaction. And I know that you all have probably been virtual just as much, if not more so, than I have in the last year. So we are going to make this an interactive, collaborative dialogue. How's that sound? Okay, woohoo, let's do it. Yay, round of applause, I like it. So thank you for choosing to spend the afternoon with me, or at least a bit of the afternoon. I won't hold you hostage too long, but like I said, I think we'll have some fun together. And this is where I envision taking our presentation today. But is there any feedback from any of you as to what you would like to see added or changed to this proposed agenda? And I can only see a few of you, so I apologize if you are trying to make eye contact with me. I'll try to expand my view as much as possible, but if I miss a head nod or a thumbs up, I do apologize. I have my chat box open, so feel free to put anything in the chat if you'd like to connect with me and I'm just not recognizing the verbal or nonverbal cues that you're giving me through the video. So moving right along, this is just kind of a brief overview to HonorHealth. Is anyone already familiar with HonorHealth? Okay, so we are mostly located, oh, I'm sorry, just been unmuting. Okay, so we're mostly located throughout the Phoenix and Scottsdale areas. That's where our 6 medical centers or hospital locations are located. However, we do have 70 plus medical group locations that span from Anthem to South Tempe and from Lake Pleasant to Fountain Hills. So chances are if you live in the Phoenix area, you have seen one of our locations, maybe drive by one of our locations on your way to work or you have one in your neighborhood. but we have 12,500 plus employees. We have our own foundation, accountable care organization. Basically what that means is we have our own network of physicians for our employee health plan, helping us to keep quality high and costs low. And we're really known for our extensive community services as well as our culture of learning and development. And I'll talk about that in a minute. And I'm so sorry, before I go any further, I'd love to hear from all of you in terms of your names and your schools that you represent. And for the sake of time, if you want to put that information in the chat box, just so I kind of know who's out there, I can make this presentation a little bit more relevant. But just briefly about me, my name is Leah Hill and I oversee our workforce development functions at HonorHealth. And basically what that means is, as a former student recruiter and as a current educator, healthcare lover, I have about 20 years of healthcare experience where I thrive on building partnerships, pathways, and pipelines into employment at HonorHealth. So I have great respect for the education industry. Family members and friends of mine are educators. And so I really feel that you all are essential members of our workforce. So thank you for what you do each and every day. And thank you for being our partner in helping us grow our future healthcare workforce. And so not only do I assist in helping individuals become employed at HonorHealth and get excited about employment at HonorHealth, and sometimes for my role, that is a long-term investment, meaning I work with K through 12 partners, for example. And as you can imagine, a kindergartner unfortunately won't be ready for HonorHealth employment for about 12 to 13 years. But I figure if Amazon can sell a STEM kit, then HonorHealth can certainly get students excited about the healthcare industry at the age of 5. So that's part of my role, but the other part of my role is overseeing our HonorHealth Learning Institute, which is our corporate university, and also overseeing the the training and development aspects and opportunities available to our non-leadership employees, which is about 10,500 of our 12,500 employee population. So working with post-secondary institutions to bring education to our employees and development opportunities for them to upskill, but also creating partnerships for their graduates to become HonorHealth employees and help us grow our future workforce. So glad to see who's out there. Shout out to all of you. And I'm glad that we have representatives from all corners of the valley. The nice thing about being virtual for me within the last year is I've been really able to paint the country purple, HonorHealth purple. Meaning that previously half car will travel, my office was my car, and I was going from location to location. But now, silver lining of the pandemic is I'm able to reach academic and community partners across the nation without leaving my home and expensing my organization for mileage reimbursement. Or I can be in California at the beginning of the day, in New York at the end of the day, or in our case, Tucson, and Flagstaff, and everywhere in between. So back to HonorHealth. A lot of times I get the question, what makes a good HonorHealth employee? Or what are you looking for in the next generation of HonorHealth employees? And this is probably conversations that you have with, or this is a sample conversation you may have with your students, with your graduates. We talk about hard skills, soft skills, essential skills, life skills, whatever we want to call them. And we'll certainly talk about those technical skills in a few minutes, as well as some additional essential skills. But first and foremost, we really want our future HonorHealth employees and our current employees to embody our values. You'll see them here on the screen in front of you. I care, innovation, collaboration, accountability, respect, and empathy. But also one of those life skills, in my opinion, and it's becoming increasingly popular, not only in the business world, but also in the healthcare world. And it's something that's been prevalent within the HonorHealth culture for many years. I've been there for 18 years. And I can remember when we were talking about diversity 10 plus years ago. And diversity is not only important in terms of being respectful of employee to employee differences. We all have those visible and invisible differences that make us unique. But it's also being able to be respectful of our patients' differences and the diversity that they bring to our to the bedside and to our hospitals. And as healthcare professionals, whether we have bedside responsibilities or administrative responsibilities, we're all ultimately responsible for patient care. And so being respectful of those differences, being empathetic, but also being able to provide culturally competent care based upon those differences. And so that's something that I'm proud to say at HonorHealth we've done for years, and we're continuing to do so, especially in light of events of 2020 and events of the future that we may not know are going to happen yet, which hopefully, unfortunately, will not happen, but we know that they may. Off to the right of this slide, you'll see kind of what we are known for at HonorHealth. We want to make healthcare personal, not only for our patients, but for our employees as well. And making healthy personal for our employees means, for example, providing them with opportunities for work-life balance, providing them with a living wage, giving them the opportunity to be able to attend their child's recital or their medical appointments, for example, and making sure that they feel as if they're part of their family dynamic, even if they have to step away from work for a few hours to participate in those engagements. Another key piece of our commitment to diversity is our commitment to veterans, as well as other special populations. Woohoo! Shout out from one of our participants and any of those who may be current service members or those who have served. We thank you for your service. The Arizona Roadmap to Veteran Employment through the being an Arizona Veteran Supportive Employer is just one of our many affiliations in supporting veterans and their transition into the workplace, or if they've already transitioned, being able to provide them with the resources that they may want or need on an ongoing basis. Woohoo, thank you for your service. Is it Mr. Quigley? Thank you for your
Ms.
service.
Quigley.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. And then also just being able to, like I said, provide not only them with resources, but with their support people, their family members, their loved ones, their children, their dependents. Some of them, for example, may be re-careering as well. So taking care of them and making sure that they feel as if they have a career at home at HonorHealth. NOAA, who's familiar with our NOAA clinics? Anyone? All right, tell us what you know about the NOAA clinics.
Is that me?
Yes, Casey, I'm sorry.
I've actually gone there before personally, but also I know their motto is access to, affordable health, but like just access to health and these types of resources to the community.
Great job. Yes, I didn't mean to put you on the spot. Perfect response. NOAA stands for Neighborhood Outreach Access to Health. And for those of you who are long-term Valley residents or may know a little bit of Valley history, HonorHealth became HonorHealth in 2015 when John C. Lincoln Health Network and Scottsdale Healthcare merged. We became a family and became HonorHealth. I was a legacy Scottsdale Healthcare employee, went from 3 hospitals to 5, and then we opened our 6th hospital last fall in the midst of the pandemic. And then NOAA, at the time that we were Scottsdale Healthcare, you can kind of see, if you're familiar with Scottsdale Healthcare, a little bit of the Scottsdale Healthcare logo still within the NOAA logo, the wave of people. But NOAA was our sister when we were Scottsdale Healthcare. And then because of the merger and them becoming their own recognized federally qualified health center, they became kind of our cousin. But the cool thing about NOAA is their employees are still HonorHealth employees, so they still get to take advantage of the cool employee benefits and everything else. But they specialize in medical, dental, and behavioral health care for underserved communities, including immigrants and refugees, but anyone can utilize a NOAA clinic. I myself have taken my daughter to a NOAA clinic because her pediatrician didn't have a flu vaccine for her age group. And they did, and I wanted her to be vaccinated as soon as possible. So we went to a NOAA clinic. Great experience, great service, just like any other HonorHealth affiliated facility. And last but not least, anyone know about magnet recognition? So magnet recognition is one of our commitments to learning and development of our employees and our future workforce. And the fact that just like the name implies, it means that we recruit and retain the best of the best when it comes to nursing professionals and all healthcare professionals. So even though it's really a recognition that nurses like to tout, I'm not a nurse, but I like to tout it too, as do my teammates, because it shows our commitment to learning and development within our workforce, our commitment to collaboration between all professionals within the healthcare industry, nurses to physicians, physicians to housekeepers, business professionals, et cetera. And it also is our commitment to having an educated workforce. So magnet recognition states that we will have to be in compliance and to continue to be recognized as magnet facilities, that 80% of our workforce will be bachelor's prepared nurses. So it's not that we don't hire diploma or associate's degree prepared nurses. We do. We find value in that education and training still. But we just ask that if we hire a diploma or associate's degree prepared nurse, that he or she receive a bachelor's degree within 30 months of employment. And we provide resources to those employees, which we'll talk about in a minute, to help them reach that goal. But usually, because magnet status is such a gold standard, most nursing professionals are just excited to work at a magnet facility and either have their bachelor's degrees or are like, yep, I'm already enrolled, or I'm enrolling next week, let's do this. So this is just a snapshot of where we're located throughout the valley. As you can see, we have our six hospitals designated by the purple H's. Our sixth one actually is where this red cross or plus sign is at I-17 in the Carefree Highway. That was formerly an HonorHealth 24/7 emergency center that became our sixth medical center last September. The blue, yellow, and green icons represent our 70 plus medical group locations in all stretches of the valley. And then you may have already started to see some HonorHealth Next Med or HonorHealth NextMed locations, FastMed, sorry. I don't know why I said NextMed. FastMed and HonorHealth formed an affiliation last fall. And so FastMed Urgent Cares are now rebranded HonorHealth FastMed locations. And they're available in locations that go further west than this map, such as Avondale, Buckeye, and further south, such as Tucson. So we're very excited that now we have locations throughout the state. We've had other opportunities to expand regionally and even nationally, but we've decided to stay local and focus on quality rather than quantity. So you probably won't see an HonorHealth location in Nevada or New Mexico or California in the years ahead. HonorHealthJobs.com is where you can find all of our current career opportunities. And I'm not trying to recruit any of you. Love to have you all, but you probably are all right where you need to be. And I'm so glad that you're there. But I give that website to you in case A, you know someone who's looking for employment, or B, to share this information with your students in terms of where are the hot jobs. And we'll talk about what those are in just a minute. But we're very fortunate that last year, in 2020, we were able to provide nearly 3,000 new career homes to individuals seeking employment. And right now we have over 1,200 career opportunities available. And that's because of COVID and ongoing growth initiatives that we haven't decided to stop as a result of COVID, such as the opening of our Neuroscience Institute later this year and our behavioral health facility as well. So it's an exciting time to be an HonorHealth employee. I wanted to talk about our culture of learning and development and how we support and champion all of our employees being able to progress and pursue their career aspirations in partnership with HonorHealth. I know this text is a little bit small. You'll receive copies of the slides, and you'll also, if you would like these emailed to you as PDFs, I'd be happy to share them with you. They are also available on honorhealthjobs.com under the career development page, where each of these playing cards, such as the yellow EVS associate aide, the blue environmental services associate, are broken down into their own pages. So you can see kind of a page view of each of these cards, whereas this is a one page view of the whole game board, if you will. CSPD, does anyone know what a central sterile processing department professional does? This is good. I like this because I want you all to realize, and I'm sure you already do, but a lot of times I talk with community members and it's the Grey's Anatomy effect. No disrespect to Grey's Anatomy, but they only realize or only see that within the healthcare environment, we have nurses and doctors. No disrespect to nurses and doctors. They help our hospital run. But at HonorHealth, we have 1,200 unique job descriptions. So within those 1,200 unique job descriptions, we're like a small town. We have our mayor, our CEO, for example. We have our photographers, our radiology professionals, our x-ray techs. We have security officers. We have landscapers. We have HR professionals. We have educators. We have marketing professionals. We all make that small city run. A CSPD professional is someone who has a very important job in the world of the operating room. And the fact that that person decontaminates and sterilizes all of the surgical materials and equipment tools used for surgeries. So they use machines and technology such as dishwashers and autoclaves, but they also, being humans, we can't replace them with machinery or artificial intelligence. They are quality control. Sometimes we all know at home our dishwashers don't usually, or I shouldn't say usually, but they sometimes don't clean our dishes to the level we want them clean. So we either have to hand wash them or wash them again. Same with a CSPD professional. We want to make sure that, and hopefully I'm not going to gross out anyone, but any blood tissue from that last patient doesn't remain on a stainless steel instrument for the next patient. This is a very common career path for individuals who start in our housekeeping department, for example. And housekeeping is one of those roles that is transferable. So we compete a lot with the resorts at our Scottsdale location for talent, our Scottsdale locations. But they were very grateful to us in the pandemic when unfortunately they had to let go a lot of their employees. We were able to hire them. Being a 24/7, 365 operation where we had an influx of patients, we needed their talent. So we were able to partner with them to borrow some of their healthcare professionals, or excuse me, their housekeeping professionals. And hopefully some of them I know are not going back because they've seen that they can build a career home at HonorHealth. It's not just a job. But when you look at these career paths, you'll see the daily tasks, the education and training required, as well as the median hourly pay, and a helpful hint for each of these professions. And again, honorhealthjobs.com has more of an expanded view. Our lab career path, is anyone aware that in the state of Arizona, there is only one bachelor's degree program for clinical lab scientists or medical technologists? There used to be three, now there's only one. The nice thing about that is lab professionals, including phlebotomists, will always have jobs, but that means that we're all competing for talent. So outpatient labs, hospitals, doctor's offices, we all need the same people. This is a great career opportunity for someone who may be introverted, but likes blood and guts. So if they say, like if you have a student that comes to you, for example, and says, I want to become a nurse, and you realize that maybe there's an opportunity for improvement with their social skills, for example, you may want to steer them towards lab. or if they feel more comfortable working autonomously rather than in a group setting. Another great way to look at lab careers. And last but not least, right now we have our nursing career path. The cool thing about the nursing career path is the nursing career path can start as early as high school with someone who is at least 18 years of age, junior, senior, who may or may not have previous healthcare experience, who's looking to look into healthcare or knows, hey, I want to become a physician, I want to become a nurse. They can start as a patient sitter and make at least minimum wage. This is an opportunity where, especially if they're in school during the day, they can work evenings or nights, of course, with parent permission. Well, if they're 18, they don't have to worry about local curfew, but they could work evenings, nights, or weekends and earn, in addition to at least $12.20 an hour, they could earn shift differential. And does anyone know what shift differential is? It's kind of like the cherry on top of the ice cream cone. It's the best part, in my opinion, in the fact that it's an added incentive for working those evening, nights, or weekends. So they may come in at, let's say, hypothetically $13.50 an hour base, but if they're working evening, nights, or weekends, they may come out working or making $18 an hour just with shift differential. And then our CNAs, our nursing assistants, are called patient care techs. And we also hire emergency medical technicians, EMTs, paramedics, and those who have completed their first semester of a nursing program into our patient care tech roles. And if you know, if you're in touch with a graduate, for example, who went through an NA program but is not certified, they don't have to be certified to apply for our patient care tech roles. And after 6 months, we will pay them to become certified. We'll give them the money towards that certification. And we'll talk about that in a minute. So any questions so far about the nursing career path or lab or CSPD or anything else we've talked about so far? I'd love to hear someone's voice and know that I'm keeping you awake out there.
I have a question for you.
Sure, Patty.
You mentioned the patient sitter, being that, you know, if they are at least 18 years old, is there a special training they would have to go through that? And what exactly does a patient sitter do? I'm assuming you sit with the patient.
You got it. Yep, that's exactly right. So this is someone who's okay with being in a quiet environment, especially with a patient who may be comatose, for example, or under the influence of medications that the provider has prescribed. It may be someone who, and bringing a book to work, for example, is perfectly acceptable within these roles, but it's someone who is also comfortable in asking for help when needed. So for example, if a patient starts to seize, unfortunately, then being able to ask for help from the nurses and any other healthcare providers who may need to respond to that seizure or a cardiac arrest, for example. But yes, it's sitting with the patient and just making sure that the patient is comfortable, maybe getting a pillow for the patient, a blanket, and just being there for the patient, and then being able to delegate when needed. So pretty cool entry-level job. It's a great way to see the healthcare industry. But at the same time, it really takes a special person who can be okay with long moments of quiet and solitude, but being able to delegate and escalate up when needed.
Well, thank you for that. I wasn't aware that such positions were available. I always thought that those seemed to be more volunteer work. So thank you.
Sure, of course. And we do have volunteers who do that too, but this is a great paid opportunity and a great entree into the world of healthcare for someone who's re-careering or looking to career for the first time.
I have a question.
Yes.
My daughter was in nursing, and she went to, I moved from Virginia to Arizona. I was born out here and I came back, and she went to Jefferson College of Health Sciences, and they were connected to Carilion Hospital System in
yes.
Roanoke, Virginia. Mm-hmm. And they have, you know, their own education program. It's a 4-year program. They had 4 years for firemen. I mean, anything related to health. Does your HonorHealth program facilities have their own education department or school?
Oh, yes. Because we are such a culture of learning and development. Welcome back to Arizona, by the way, Tracy. Thank you for your question. You're welcome. So because we are such a believer in training and development, learning and development, upskilling our workforce, education is very big at HonorHealth. We have a clinical education department. We have a center for clinical excellence that really works on providing training opportunities and educational opportunities to keep our healthcare providers current with their skills and requirements of their jobs. We have an academic affairs department that works, for example, with our local medical students and those who come to us for rotations, including nurse practitioners and nurse anesthetists. And then we also have a student placement team that oversees all student placements, such as clinical rotations, internships, externships of our clinical and non-clinical students who are performing on-site learning experiences with us.
Do you happen to have partnerships with ASU and the University of Arizona for medical people?
Oh, definitely. Yes. So we have partnerships not only for clinical rotations for their students, but we also have partnerships for our existing employees to do to take advantage of their educational programs through a tuition reduction type relationship. So stretching our tuition assistance benefit further, which we'll talk about in a minute.
Thank you for answering my questions.
Oh, of course. No, we have lots of academic partners, both locally and nationally. Not only to grow our future talent pools, but also to help our current employees.
That's good, because over the years I've taught careers and things, and I've had quite a few young ladies and some young men that wanted to go into the nursing field. So it's good to know this, pulling them in the right direction here.
Oh, definitely. No, well, kudos to you, and thank you for helping us train that next generation.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions or comments out there?
Yes. Hi, Leah. Can you hear me?
I can. Hello.
Hi. I had a question. I would like to know, what is the entry-level career path for anyone interested in laboratory science or lab testing? Would that be a lab assistant? And if so, what credentialing would you require if they're just starting in that area?
So in regards to the lab career path, this was the second one I presented. And again, these slides will be emailed to you, and this is available on honorhealthjobs.com under the career development page. But I would recommend having someone who's interested in lab sciences start as a phlebotomist, and then maybe pursuing a clinical lab assistant program, and then a medical lab technician program, which are both associate's degree programs. And a bachelor's degree is not required in this field, but certainly something that's encouraged. And even if they were aspiring lab professional were to start with us as a phlebotomist, we could help that professional upskill and take advantage of CLA or medical lab technician programs or even medical technology programs with our tuition assistance program, which I'll talk about in a minute.
Okay, yeah, I'm thinking about students that have already graduated from our program and are majoring in a bachelor's degree in biology or chemistry. But I didn't know that phlebotomy would be the entry level on that for someone already in a degree program, but not majoring in laboratory sciences.
Thank you for clarifying. Let's talk about that a little bit further. So in regards to individuals who are pursuing bachelor's degrees in one of the physical or life sciences, such as microbiology or hematology, chemistry, biology, et cetera, we do offer on-the-job training within our lab environment with our lab professionals. It's encouraged, if possible, for them to specialize just like they would in a medical lab technician or a medical technology program in one of the areas of the lab, such as hematology, blood bank, et cetera, just so they can be prepared to kind of jump into one of those areas. But based upon the training and where they have trained, we do offer some on-the-job training opportunities. We just find that if they haven't been in a lab environment before, or if they're not specialized in one of those areas, it's almost like retraining. And we want to give those individuals an opportunity and a chance, because there's so many of them out there. And unfortunately, a lot of them we know are working in the restaurant industry, for example, when we could utilize them. But it's helpful if they have kind of some foundation of one of the lab areas, so we can at least kind of start them off at more of a secondary level rather than a foundational level.
Got it. Thank you very much for clarifying that.
Sure. And thank you for clarifying your question. I'm sorry if I took us down a road that you weren't intending at the beginning.
Oh, no, that's okay. Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions? Anna or Anna says she's driving, so we're going to wish her safety in reaching her destination. Please do turn off your camera. All right, so let's go ahead and talk featured career opportunities. Again, I present this information to you all so you kind of know what we're looking for currently. But to be honest with you, I don't anticipate this list changing too drastically within the calendar year or even the next 2 to 3 years. Why? Any guesses? I'm sorry if I'm making you all work too hard this afternoon. I really, like I said, I love to engage with you. So, go ahead.
An aging population.
Thank you. Yes, definitely. We are right in the Sun Belt. We have an aging population, but also here, regardless of geographical location, whether if we were in Arizona or Alaska, we have a sicker population as a nation, unfortunately. So our patients are sicker pre-COVID and probably post-COVID too, unfortunately. We're always going to see women who are going to be having babies. Sorry, guys, we haven't figured out how you can help us out with that. We're working on it, but women are always going to be giving birth, and we have a sicker aging population, and we're going to need healthcare professionals for years to come. It's kind of sobering, but it's also exciting. Exactly. Thank you, Annette. Yes. COVID, lack of primary care physicians. There's going to be a need for advanced level providers such as nurse practitioners to kind of come up from the ranks. And I mean, a lot of us are used to only seeing primary care physicians, but I think the model is going to be shifting and we're going to start to see more advanced level providers caring for us as well. But another reason is, again, I kind of briefly mentioned before, at our Scottsdale locations, for example, we compete with the hospitality industry. So we need environmental services professionals, housekeeping professionals, but also at all of our locations, just like any other hospital or healthcare provider, we compete with the restaurant industry. We have to feed our patients. We have to feed our employees. We have to feed our patient support people. So food services, whether that be individuals at the most entry level, dishwashers, that's a great way for students, new grads from high school or college to get their feet in the door, especially if they don't have healthcare experience or they want to stay away from the bedside. But also those who are going to culinary school. We hire a lot of chefs from culinary schools such as Scottsdale Community College, Le Cordon Bleu when it was here locally. And I mean, the food is fantastic. I actually look forward to going to the hospital just so I can have the food. But also I'm a geek like that. I like going to the hospital. So, I mean, keep this list in mind. Pardon my acronyms, RRT, a registered respiratory therapist at the very bottom bullet, PTs are physical therapists, OTs, occupational therapists, and STs are speech therapists. And those all, RRTs, that's an associate's degree program. There are bachelor's degree bridge programs available, but PT, OT, and speech right now, PT is definitely a post-secondary doctorate degree. OT and speech therapy are recommended at master's degree prepared professionals. But the cool thing about HonorHealth, like almost any other hospital, is that we hire entry-level through executive-level professionals. And you don't have to be a master's or doctorate prepared professional to start with us. Everyone has to start somewhere. And yes, an occupational therapy assistant, an OTA, that's a great career path. You're exactly right in terms of being able to start as an OTA, stay an OTA, you're making a difference. You're being able to see your patient progress most likely and be able to lead a successful independent life. So HonorHealthJobs.com is where all of these positions are posted. The ones on the left, like I said, are just the hot jobs or the ones where we have current immediate vacancies and where I see vacancies in the years ahead. Those who are looking for employment can apply to as many positions as are available. As a certified career coach, I just recommend that an applicant does not apply to 10 positions in 10 minutes, that they methodically go through an application and differentiate their application for each position. We don't require cover letters, but I tell them to get to know HonorHealth. Go to honorhealth.com, kind of learn the language of HonorHealth in terms of our values, which we talked about a few minutes ago, but also infuse some of the words used in the job posting included within their resume. So they're speaking the language of the recruiter and the organization. And there's a question out there about educational background for case managers. So usually case managers are both nurses and social workers. There are some that are just social workers, but usually they have both nursing training and social work training. And that can be a combination of, like, for example, a bachelor's degree in nursing and a master's in social work. That can be a bachelor's in social work and a master's in nursing. Or that can be, for a lot of our experienced case managers, maybe having a nursing degree and kind of learning case management on the side, which is something you don't see as often anymore because of the need for formal education. But we still have some seasoned case managers out there who provide great wealth to our patient experiences at HonorHealth as a result of their on-the-job training. And our current process is highlighted on honorhealthjobs.com, but I do like to highlight to educators and students that we do require a background check and a drug screen. And that's because we work with vulnerable populations. And it's always a great way for me to talk with, especially, unfortunately, middle school students and maybe high school students about not starting drug use if they haven't. Because we do screen for common substances such as amphetamines and barbiturates, but we also screen for cotinine. Does anyone know what cotinine is? Nicotine. So as a healthcare professional, as a healthcare provider, we want to be able to walk the talk. If we're telling our patients that we advise them to stop smoking, we can't lean over smelling like smoke, telling them to stop smoking. So we want to be able to walk the talk as models and good stewards of health, but we also want to be able to provide greater outcomes to our patients. And so we do screen for the nicotine patch, for example, or Nicorette. And our drug screening process is not a pass-fail, it's cleared or not cleared, meaning we know every case is different. Some individuals may be on prescription medications, including medical marijuana. And those applicants have an opportunity to talk with our medical review officers, who are physicians, to be cleared, because they may have stopped smoking 6 months ago, but chew Nicorette gum once a month. Most likely that is a situation that'll be cleared, because we believe in reform and being able to help that individual on their path to good health. So this is just a small sampling of our HonorHealth benefits. And actually, before I go into benefits, I want to stop right there. I didn't prepare a slide for this because I wanted to have an organic conversation. So in regards to when you look at these future career opportunities, you think about our career paths that we presented just a few minutes before. Let's have a conversation about life skills, soft skills, essential skills, and hard skills. I didn't put together a slide because there's so many words, if you were to think of a word cloud, that I could see on that word cloud as to what skills are important within our future healthcare workforce and our current healthcare workforce. But based upon what we've talked about today, what skills do you think are important for our healthcare employees? Sorry, pop quiz time.
I would say bedside manner, just being able to connect with a patient.
Definitely. And that kind of, I think, goes into our empathy value for sure. Thank you for that. Yes. compassion, definitely. Bedside manner, I call it being patient-centric, being able to understand the patient's needs, even if that patient can't convey those needs, but also being able to communicate, thank you, Kara, communication skills, those needs and expectations of that patient to your teammates, being able to collaborate and make sure that you're all meeting those patients' expectations. Collaboration for sure. Yes, making decisions in the moment independently and knowing when to ask for help, diversity, dedication, exactly right. What about stress management? Important in healthcare? For sure, yes. What about coordination? Being able to coordinate your thoughts and actions with the thoughts and actions of your teammates, right? Yes, ability to handle multiple tasks, definitely. And when we talk communication skills, it's written communication, it's email communication, it's verbal communication, being able to assert yourself or assert your patient's needs when needed. Soft skills and emotional intelligence, for sure. Any others out there? Dedication, perseverance, time management, being able to be on time, right? You don't want your teammates waiting for you as a patient is waiting for you. I love it. Listening more than speaking. Yes. Like the old Native American proverb. I love it. We have two ears and one mouth. We should proportionally use them accordingly. So important in healthcare. Commitment, definitely. Okay. Excellent. Any others out there? You all were excellent. Great. You hit a lot more than I thought we would hit. So HonorHealth benefits, again, I'm not trying to recruit any of you, but I present this information not only so that you see that we have a culture of learning and development, but we really care about our employees and giving them opportunities to live their lives professionally and personally and have that work-life balance, but also by working towards something. And there was another one out there in terms of skills, cultural sensitivity. Yep. Exactly right. The HonorHealth benefits that I really want to focus in on within today's presentation revolve around education and development. And those are my favorite, our tuition assistance. Our tuition assistance program, I'm biased, is one of the best in the industry, but I've researched and I've done some secret shopping and talked with family and friends at some of our competitors. But I have every right to be biased because not only do we guarantee it to all of our employees who qualify, and to qualify, it's working 16 hours a week, 1/6, after 6 months of service. Our competitors, it's either a lottery system, no disrespect to them, don't get me wrong, but it's either a lottery system where your employee number has to be drawn each year to participate. If it's not drawn, you may have tuition assistance year one of your bachelor's degree program, but not year two, or it's first come, first serve. So if you sign up for a class in August and the money's gone, you're out of luck. Our program also extends to our employees the opportunity for prepaid tuition, meaning that if they're studying a clinical program, taking a clinical related class that leads to a clinical career path at HonorHealth, nursing, respiratory therapy, radiology, lab, it's prepaid up front in their paychecks after 6 months of employment. If they're studying a non-clinical program such as nursing or business or marketing, human resources, education, it's reimbursed. In addition to tuition assistance every year, we offer $800 to $3,500 per year to our employees as long as they're eligible, same eligibility as tuition assistance, after 6 months of employment, working 16 hours a week, to pursue professional development opportunities, going to conferences, in-state or out-of-state, associated travel expenses with those conferences, lodging, travel expenses, transportation, or joining a professional development group, or pursuing a non-academic professional development certification, such as becoming a certified nursing assistant. Our medical, dental, and vision insurance start on day one of the first month of employment. So if you were just, or if someone was hypothetically starting today, those benefits would take effect on May 1st, We offer on-site childcare centers at two of our locations, John C. Lincoln and Shea, and then in-home childcare in case of an emergency, as well as elder care. We are starting English as a second language in high school completion classes later this year. Because we're a nonprofit, our 403B plan, retirement plan, starts on day one of employment, fully vested at an optional 4% company match. And then any guesses as to how much paid time off we offer in the first year of employment for full-time employees? Twelve days. Any other guesses out there? Go higher. We offer.
I'm going to go with 30.
30 days. Okay. I like it. Is that calendar days or is that business days? I guess either way.
Probably business, I would think, because okay. That would be really nice to then pull it into your weekend. So
about four and a half weeks. I like it. Yeah. Okay. So we offer in the first year of employment, it's based upon seniority, 240 hours of paid time off. So that equates to 6 weeks of holiday time, vacation time, mental health days, whatever you want to call them, in addition to 2 weeks of paid sick time. So 8 weeks in the first year of employment for full-time employees. Being there 18 years, luckily with COVID, no one can max out on vacation, but I'm eligible for up to 420 hours a year of vacation time, and I'm at 500 hours. I need to take some vacation time. It's just finding the time, right? And so real quick, I saw some questions in the chat box. Let me go back to those real quick. I want to make sure that I'm addressing those before we go too far down the line. Can tuition assistance or tuition reimbursement apply to master's degrees as well? Yes, both prepaid and reimbursed tuition can be applied to high school completion, bachelor's, associate's degree, master's, and doctoral programs. If it's bedside care related, it's the prepaid. If it's like a master's in business, it's reimbursed. And then in regards to in-demand jobs, at this time, just based upon weekly and quarterly analytics, rad techs, radiology technology, or technologists are not in demand. That doesn't mean that they're not in demand across the industry, just not at HonorHealth right now. And that's just because we're very fortunate in the fact that we don't have an attrition issue at this time, and that department is not growing. But an area that is growing is respiratory therapy. And we have a partnership with Gateway Community College, for example, where HonorHealth employees can bypass the year and a half, 2 year wait list. And as soon as they complete their prereqs, they're admitted into the program. And in regards to, and I'm sorry, Kara, I wasn't on here at the right time, but tell me a little bit more about managing mental and emotional health. Oh, PTO.
Yeah, you mentioned the paid time off and how much time you get. I'm like, oh, wow, that's where you manage that.
Exactly. And that's important to us at HonorHealth. We're very big on the social determinants of health. For those of you who are familiar with those, that's a term that the CDC has coined within, I think it was first mentioned in Healthy People 2000, where our health is determined based upon where we live, where we work, how we worship, if we don't worship, et cetera. And so we feel that giving our employees access to financial as well as health and welfare benefits will help their social determinants of health. So we're very big in giving those resources to our employees. All right, so moving right along, I think that's our last slide before I encourage you to connect with us either through Facebook or LinkedIn, or if you know of a job seeker, you're a job seeker yourself, join our talent community so we can stay in touch with you. And then last but not least, I would be happy to connect with any or all of you if you're looking for a guest speaker in your classroom, if you're looking for opportunities to talk further with either you, yourselves, or your students. being a certified career coach, I can talk with them either one-on-one or in group settings. We can do assessments as to where they may fit in within the healthcare industry. We can have a lot of fun together. We can do one-on-one coaching and counseling when it comes to choosing an academic program or maybe what career opportunities are available to them if they don't like blood and guts, or if they want to go into finance, but they don't realize that we have a finance department and that healthcare finance is pretty cool, whatever it may be. And so now I will turn it over to all of you for questions, if you haven't had your questions already answered.
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
I recently was informed that one of our state universities offers a bachelor's in nursing, but with an emphasis on integrated health. I'm seeing that that's more and more the trend nationwide. Does your facility, do you all see a bachelor's of nursing, the general bachelor's of nursing we would all have all been exposed to versus the bachelor's of nursing with integrated health? Do you see that as a benefit when it comes to hiring someone?
So I would encourage any nursing professional, yes, definitely, to become specialized or even certified in certain areas of interest. It does make them more marketable. It's certainly not required, but it just opens up a lot more doors in terms of career pathing possibilities. And so whether it be integrated health, public health, cardiology, obstetrics, whatever it may be, I would say go for it.
Thank you.
Sure. And then, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just think you have a few questions in the chat. So if others are not speaking up, there are a couple questions in the chat.
Thanks, Casey. So in regards to hiring translators, yes, we have an interpretation and translation services department, and we do hire professionals into that department. We do ask that they be certified interpreters or translators. And I know Phoenix Children's Hospital, for example, has a program where they do certification for almost all of the Valley hospitals. And then there are also programs available online and through academic providers, both locally and distance learning. But yes, we hire them for more of our common languages that require translating or interpretation locally. And those would be like Spanish, for example. We have a very big African population, like Somalian population at a few of our locations, Middle Eastern. And then kind of for the least common languages, we use a translation services phone where the patient speaks into the phone. And then through the other end, we can understand what he or she is saying. And then we speak English and it translates into their native language. And that's a very common model. But because we do require these individuals to be certified, that ties back to our accreditation, because we want to make sure that we aren't necessarily like, for example, I speak Spanish. And so because there's so many different dialects of Spanish, we don't want there to be confusion if I'm speaking Castilian Spanish and the family member is speaking more Southwestern, like Mexican Spanish, for example. And so we want to make sure there are no barriers when it comes to providing care and treatment of the patient. And then in terms of my educational background, I'm an educational junkie. Not only do I love to be a student, but I also love to be a teacher. And so my bachelor's degree, I actually wanted to become a physician. And then through mentoring and internships, realized that I wanted to be a surgeon. I was more people oriented. So I was advised to go more into kind of a physical therapy type profession. Found a passion there in physical therapy, even thought about going into software development for at-home physical therapy patients. And after I decided not to pursue those career paths, because again, I was advised that I would be spending more time doing insurance billing than with the patients where I really thrived, I found that my three loves were the convergence of education, business, and healthcare. Have a master's degree in organizational leadership with project management. Yep, definitely a lifelong learner. And then have about 9 certifications ranging from Six Sigma to career coaching to national workforce development professional, et cetera. So very long answer, but love to learn. And then in regards to job shadowing opportunities, right now in our COVID environment, unfortunately, we've had to discontinue job shadowing opportunities due to the health and safety of our patients and our community members, but we're hoping to resume those. There may be in the near future, hoping that we aren't on the fourth wave of COVID as we speak, there may be opportunities for virtual shadowing or informational interviews. I'm working with our teams and coordinating those, but more to come. So please stay in touch with me if that's something you're interested in. What else is out there? I know we're at time, but I'm happy to stick around if anyone wants to talk privately or if you have to head out. Thank you for spending an hour with us and look forward to connecting with you offline.
Well, Leah, thank you so much for this information. I mean, just looking at the chats, you can tell everyone really, you know, thought this was so useful. And I know that they're going to be able to apply this content back to their classrooms in some sort of way. So I will reach out and maybe get some of this information that you have, and then I can pass it along to our educators. Or I know you also have your contact information as well, so I can also include that too if you're open to it. But whatever you think is best, then I just want to say thank you again.
Of course. And yes, I also wanted to mention just real quick, we are recruiting for our summer teen volunteer program. And I was going to drop my contact information again if anyone wants to take a screenshot or a picture. But that is another way for young adults and students to become involved as well. So if you'd like more information, just reach out to me and I'll make sure to assist you in getting that information.
Definitely a great resource. I know we're gonna definitely have some educators take you up on that.
Well, thank you all for your interest and for your time today. And I do hope to connect with you offline. So thank you for all that you do for our community and for our next generation of all professionals. And we just really appreciate being partners with you and hope to continue that partnership in the days ahead.
Thank you.
You're welcome.